Man, this washroom sucks. If only there's a place for me to get some inspiration. Huh, why don't I? Pinterest was first launched back in March 2010 when web development was simple. Ah, remember the LAMP stack? Good times. At the time, they started out with two founders and one engineer. Their tech stack consisted of a small web engine and one small MySQL database. In January 2011, they continued to release a product in stealth mode and evolve based on user feedback. At this time, they brought in another engineer on board and moved to AWS. Their tech stack now uses Amazon EC2, S3, CloudFront for CDN, one Nginx web server, four web engines, one MySQL database with one replica, one task queue, two task processors, and one MongoDB for tracking analytics. In September 2011, they started to see explosive growth where users are doubling every single month. This is the stage where they did a lot of experimentation. They then hired another software engineer and started adding a lot of different technologies to their stack, including Cassandra, Membase, Elasticsearch Instance. During this time, they were using 5 different databases alone, for science of course. Their insane growth meant that all their technologies were pushed to their absolute limit, leading to things breaking all the time. It was reported that some databases in MySQL were growing so fast that their index ran out of memory. They realized that they need to spread their data across different servers in order to handle this ever-increasing load. They stopped all new features immediately and came up with strategies for dealing with this growth. They ultimately came up with 2 potential solutions to solve their ever-growing MySQL database. 1. Clustering, or 2. Sharding their database. Database clustering is the process of distributing data across multiple different servers, all working together to act as a single system. These nodes often communicate with each other to maintain consistency and balance across the entire cluster. Pinterest was already using Cassandra and employed this type of architecture. However, at the time, it was in its early phase and did not have much community support. They faced various issues with the cluster management algorithm, which is used to coordinate and organize nodes within the cluster. There were 4 issues that Pinterest faced during the usage of clustering. 1. Issue with data rebalance. When they would bring up a new box and data starts replicating, it would just get stuck there. 2. Data corruption. If there was a bug in the cluster management algorithm, it would corrupt all data on all their nodes. 3. Improper load balancing. In response to uneven distribution of workload, there is a manual process available to redistribute the data across the nodes more evenly. However, over time, the data would end up being redistributed back to the original node. 4. Data authority failure. In one scenario, they brought up in a secondary node and it started to replicate data from the primary node to the secondary. At 80% completion, the secondary goes, "I'm the primary now," and the original primary would give up authority, resulting in the other 20% of data being lost. In the end, they decided to drop Cassandra, Membase, and MongoDB from their technology stack. This meant that they would only stick with MySQL and will go with the sharding approach to deal with the scaling issues. Sharding is a technique where a large database is partitioned into smaller, more manageable pieces called shards. Each shard is essentially a smaller database and is hosted on a separate server. Unlike clustering, each shard acts independent of one another and does not cross-communicate. Their original database state included foreign keys, joins, and constraints. In order to prepare for the transition, they denormalized their database. They combined their tables in order to get rid of the usage of foreign keys and joins. This may include redundant data, however, because in a sharded environment, you cannot directly access data that resides in another shard. They then introduced read replica to handle read queries and improve overall database performance. They also introduced caching to reduce the amount of traffic hitting the database. One of the issues that they encountered during the process was replication lag, which occurs when changes made to the primary database are not immediately reflected in the replica. This can lead to a situation where a read query on the replica will return stale data. This was solved by storing the recently updated data inside the cache. Subsequent requests to that specific data can now be served from the cache instead of hitting the database directly. If the request data does not exist inside the cache, they then can query from the replica. This will be okay to do so since the data has not been touched recently. Next came sharding. They had a goal in mind with sharding, which is to minimize the number of queries and database accesses needed to render a single page. To accomplish this, new user data would be randomly distributed across the available shards, and all data associated with the user would live on the same shard. This makes it easier to render the user profile since you don't have to query across multiple shards. They initially created virtual shards with 8 physical servers, each hosting 512 databases and all databases having all tables. They then used multi-master replication approach where each master was assigned to a different availability zone. In case of failure, the system would immediately switch to the other master and spin up a new one right away. The final transition uses ID sharding database, where the record's ID tells you exactly which shard to look for. Each data uses a 64-bit ID structure, where the first 16 bits is used to determine the shard ID. Each application has a configuration file that maps its shard range to a physical host for easier lookup. For example, the shard range 1 to 512 maps to this physical host. The next 10 bits is used for determining what type of ID this is. For example, boards, users, pins, and the remaining 38 bits for the MySQL auto increment. This ID strategy was enough to support 65,536 shards, but they initially only opened 4,096 at first and planned to expand as needed. The switch to the sharded database didn't happen immediately. There was a period of time when they were using the old system while bringing up the sharded system to life. During this time, all writes would continue to write to the old system while replicating the data onto the new sharded databases. Once it was confirmed that the sharded environment was working correctly, they cut the old system and pointed to the sharded system. While on the new sharded environment, they would experience a load increase on a specific shard. When this happened, they would first monitor their code commits to see if it was caused by some recent changes. If it was determined that it was just a load increase, they would split the database up. Before splitting, they would create replicas on the primary nodes on server A and move part of database 1 to virtual shard 2 on server C. During this transition period, writes would still go to the old nodes and get replicated to the new one. Once the transition is completed, the connection between the old and the new nodes were cut, and the application code would update accordingly with the new database assignments. Sharding did come with other issues. With sharding, they had to give up on foreign keys, joins, and constraints. These logics were instead moved to the application layer, as you cannot join on two different shards. 2. They lose all transaction capabilities. Transaction is a sequence of one or more operations that are executed as a single unit, ensuring atomicity, consistency, isolation, and durability, where either all operations are successfully completed or none are applied at all. This fails in a sharded environment due to multiple reasons. One of them is if a transaction involves updates to multiple shards and one of them fails, ensuring that changes are rolled back consistently across all shards is very challenging. And 3, schema changes require a lot more planning. After the architecture cleanup in January 2012, their tech stack was simplified to just this. In October 2012, they start to see even more traffic, and to accommodate this, they simply just add more boxes. There are a few takeaways from this. 1, your architecture is doing the right thing if you can just spin up more boxes to solve your problems. 2, the less your data move across your nodes, the more stable your architecture is. 3, everything will fail, so try to keep it simple. Thank you for watching. Please let me know if there are technical blocks that you'd like me to cover in the future. And as always, thank you for watching. See you in the next one.